Hello, this video is about Fusarium wilt of tomato. Now, tomato in Hindi we call it as tamatar, and you must have heard a very famous funny rhyme about tomato, that is aha tamatar pada hi mazedar. But anyways, this video is not about rhyme, so let's focus on the disease Fusarium wilt that occurs in the tomato plant. And here we will discuss about the occurrence, about the symptoms that are observed in the Fusarium wilt of tomato, the disease cycle, the control measures, and a lot of other things. So let's begin one by one. Disease Fusarium wilt of tomato was first described by G.E. Messier in 1895 in England. This disease is caused by a fungal pathogen named as Fusarium oxysporum. The full name of the fungi is Fusarium oxysporum subspecies Lycopersicae, that is, Fusarium is the genus, Oxysporum is the species, and Lycopersicae is the subspecies. This fungi is a member of Ascomycota and of the family Nectariaceae. Now, before discussing as to what the disease is about and how the disease is caused, let us first know what the pathogen looks like so that we can identify the pathogen in the lab. When the scientists isolated the fungi from the diseased plants, they found out that the fungi is of mycelial type, that is made up of hyphal networks, many hyphal networks. And each hyphae was found to be multicellular and septate, that is, the cells were separated by walls, common walls, and were found to be hyaline, that is, the appearance was found somewhat colorless or very lightly colored and had a very glossy appearance. The fungus produces three types of spores, Microconidia, Macroconidia, and Chlamydospore. The mycelium is colorless at first, but with age it becomes cream colored, pale pink, or somewhat purplish. That is, it was observed that as the mycelium became older and older, it tended to change their color. Next is occurrence of pathogen and how the pathogen spreads. So the fungus prefers warm weather, that is, hot climate, warm soil, warm atmosphere, warm air, acidic, that is, low pH conditions, that is, low pH of the soil and sandy soils. The fungus is seed-borne, that is, the fungus can live and survive within the seeds. The fungus is soil-borne, that is, can live and survive within the soil, maybe in their sporal form or in their mycelial form. And are thought to spread long distances in this manner. That is, when the soil having the fungi is carried away by wind, water, or any other biotic or abiotic agents, it gets spreaded to long distances. The same can be seen with the case of infected seeds, that is, when the infected seeds are cultivated, the fungi starts growing within these infected plants and starts producing spores. When these spores are released, they infect other plants and thus gets spreaded. Now, the optimum temperature has been found to be between 26 to 32 degrees Celsius. That is, at this temperature, the fungus is most active, most aggressive, because it can grow very profusely at this temperature. So an area having this temperature will be the worst affected, the very badly it will be affected. It was also found that low nitrogen, low phosphorus, and high potassium content of soil favors the growth of the fungi. Now, one thing to be noted is that this is the optimum temperature, and hence it was observed that when the temperature was made very high, that is, very hot, or when the temperature was made very low, that is, very cold, the fungus was not able to work properly. There are certain symptoms by which the disease can be identified, like yellowing of the lower leaves. First, the leaves at the lower side start to become yellow. Clearing of the veinlets, that is, the veinlets of the leaf starts to lose their original green color and starts to become yellowish in color. If you don't know what is the difference between veins and veinlets, I would recommend you to watch the video that is being shown in the I button. Chlorosis, that is, yellowing of the leaves occur. The petioles and leaves droop, wilt, and die. That is, the petioles droop. It means usually the petioles are like this, but in this condition the petiole starts to droop. It means it starts to bend downwards and the leaf starts to wilt and die. Usually the symptoms occur only on one side of the plant initially, and after that the symptoms are seen in both the sides of the plant. The disease progresses up the stem until all the foliage is killed. That is, initially the symptoms are observed in the lower side, and gradually the symptoms are seen in the upper side of the plant, and it affects the whole foliage until the plant dies. The plant becomes stunted, and one very confirmatory symptom that occurs is if the stem is cut transversely, that is, horizontally, and observed, and if there is a brownish ring-like structure observed there around the vascular bundle, this is a very confirmatory sign that the plant is infected with Fusarium oxysporum. And it is actually this reddish brown ring like discoloration, that is our Fusarium oxysporum lycopersici. And if we want to isolate the fungi, we need to isolate this reddish part, this reddish ring like part. Now the disease cycle. The disease cycle is divided into several steps. The first step is the penetration step. This is the step where the fungus penetrates or enters inside the plant. For example, the different types of spores present in the soil, be it chlamydospore, the macroconidia or the microconidia, germinate and form a small hyphae. This small hyphae then enters into the plant by the root hairs, that is these structures, the root hairs. But this is not the only pathway by which the penetration has been observed. The penetration of the hyphae can also occur by wounds present in the plant or by the cracks formed during the lateral root formation. The hyphae enters by releasing certain chemical compounds. Now the second step is invasion in the root cortex and reaching the xylem vessel. That is, these are the root hairs, and suppose this is the spore and this is a small hyphae and it has entered into the root hair. Now once the hyphae has entered into the root hair, now it invades in the cortex, that is it grows and then reaches the cortex. After reaching the cortex, it then spreads within the cortex and reaches the endodermis, then to the pericycle and ultimately to the xylem. The third step is spread through the xylem vessel. That is, once the fungal hyphae has entered into the vessel, the xylem vessel, it now, that is suppose this hyphae is coming from here, it has entered the vessel and now it starts to grow within the vessel and start to spread within the vessel through the pits. These gaps are called as pits. So the hyphae moves through these pits and starts to grow. Usually, and also along with growing, it also starts to branch. And usually it has been seen that the mycelium moves usually in the upward direction, that is towards the apex of the plant. Now while moving, as said, it also branches and forms certain small spores called as conidia, the macroconidia and the microconidia. These macroconidia and microconidia ultimately get detached and moves in the upward direction along with the xylem sap that is coming from the roots. And moves along with the xylem sap. Xylem sap is the mixture of water and nutrients that is coming from the root. Now, hence we can say that and the xylem sap basically moves where? It basically moves to the different parts of the plants like leaves, that is the photosynthetic parts generally. Now, we can say that wherever the destination of xylem sap is, the spore also reaches there. And after reaching that particular destination, they start invading other xylem vessels by germinating over there. Thus, in this way, many xylem vessels get infected and gets invaded by the particular fungi. Now, soon the plant detects the pathogen and tries to stop the spread of this fungal hyphae. And for doing so, certain cells of the xylem vessels starts to form balloon-like outgrowths by overgrowing and starts to protrude towards the xylem vessel. Also, certain gums are also secreted. So at present, in this condition, inside the vessels, there is presence of pyloses, there is presence of gums, which is secreted by the plant, and also the mycelium. This supposes the mycelium. The TS at this stage will look kind of like this, that is the transverse section. But gradually, the size of these styloses, this balloon-like structure, this is actually the styloses. Now, these styloses, gradually the size as well as the number of styloses will increase and also the amount of gums. Because of this increasing amount of gums and the styloses, the xylem vessel will start getting blocked and ultimately it will become very blocked, something like this. Because of this blockage, the mycelium won't be able to travel through this particular xylem vessel. But this is called as clogging of the vessels. So because of the clogging of this vessel, the movement or the travel of pathogen, that is the fungal hyphae, it stopped. But along with the stoppage of the movement of the pathogen, the movement of water and nutrients through the vessels also gets stopped because of this blockage present over here in the vessels. So the uptake and translocation of water and nutrient gets stopped. Now, without water and nutrients in the upper parts of the plant becomes deficient of water and nutrients and starts to wilt. The reason it gets wilted is because the water is not reaching to that particular part of the plant, that is the upper parts of the plant, but the upper parts of the plant are still respiring, are still transpiring. That is the water vapor, that is they are still releasing water vapors. And the stomatas are open and the photosynthesis process and everything is going normal. But one point is reached when the rate of transpiration becomes very high with respect to the water that is reaching over this particular part of the plant, that is the upper parts of the plant. And it is then that the stomata starts to close because the amount of water there becomes very deficient. Now, this because of the closure of the stomata, photosynthesis is not able to happen properly. The water availability in the upper parts are low, and as a result of which the plant starts to droop, they starts to wilt, and ultimately starts to become yellow, deficient in nutrients, and ultimately fall off. And there's a very pretty good chance that the leaf that has fallen might have tiny spores or mycelium present in it. So when this particular part, the infected part, falls on the ground, on the soil also gets infected. Then again the process can be repeated because the soil now has spores. The spores can again germinate and infect other plant, and hence the disease cycle keeps on continuing. Now whatever I explained in the disease cycle, certain notes have been given here. You can just simply go through them, take a screenshot or write it down as per your wish. This is the second phase. Now the one thing that we talked is that this particular fungi has three types of spores. One is Microconidia, Macroconidia and Chlamydospores. So Microconidia, as the name suggests, are very small colorless spores which are one-celled. The Macroconidias are larger than the Microconidia. They are multicellular. They are again colorless. They are slightly curved, as you can see here. They are not entirely straight but slightly curved. Then are made up of up to 6 cells. That is generally they have about 4 to 6 cells in general. Chlamydospores is the third type of spore that is formed in this type of fungi. Chlamydospores are roundish, thick-walled and may form in or on the mycelium. So this is the last slide and it is about the control measures, that is how the disease can be controlled. So one way the disease can be controlled is by regular inspection, by inspecting the plants regularly, and if any plant is suspected, that plant should be immediately checked and removed and destroyed in a very isolated place. The greenhouse gas, the greenhouse and seed bed soil must be disinfected using steam or soil fumigant like chlorpicrin, Vorlex or methyl bromide, etc. Crop rotation should be done with a non-host crop like cereals. That is, usually it has been seen that Fusarium species are very pathogenic to the members of Solanaceae. So no such plant should be placed or cultivated in that area for about 4 years which belong to the family Solanaceae. The next is healthy seeds should be used and disease resistant varieties should be used. The seeds should be disinfected first, maybe by hot water treatment or other treatments. So now I didn't find any disease resistant varieties as of now, but if I find in future, I'll be telling them in my Telegram channel in future if I find any. So thank you. This is it for this video. Take care.